Hi, do you suspect you have PCOS, but you are not sure what are the symptoms? Stay tuned because I'm going to be going through all the diagnostic criteria and most common symptoms for women in PCOS. Now, as I mentioned before, I'm going to quickly, very, very briefly go through the diagnostic criteria for PCOS. I have a separate video about it, so if you haven't seen it yet, make sure you do. But I'm going to briefly mention them. And first criteria is oligo or anovulation, which means that it's not cyclical, not regular ovulation or lack of ovulation at all. The second is hyperandrogenism, which means high androgen levels in your body. And the third one is polycystic ovaries on ultrasonogram. To get diagnosed with PCOS, you have to have only two of those three Rotterdam criteria, and they can be also diagnosed in different ways. For example, hyperandrogenism can be diagnosed by blood test, but can it also be diagnosed by only observation? So for example, we're going to be talking about it in a minute, but for example, stuff like acne, excessive hair growth or hair loss are a sign of hyperandrogenism. But let's go through the most common symptoms. First symptom is going to be insulin resistance. And I want to preface that all of those symptoms that I'm going to mention are intertwining a little bit with themselves, and one symptom can then cause an array of other symptoms as well. So first symptom is going to be insulin resistance. So insulin resistance is when your body is not creating energy in a proper way. So what actually happens? I have a separate video about insulin resistance explained, so please, please watch it. It's a very cool graphic explanation of how actually insulin resistance happens in your body and what happens on a cellular level. But if you have insulin resistance, you can have other symptoms, like for example, eating disorders, like weight gain. And that can also cause a high level of androgens, especially testosterone in your body, which I'm going to be talking about in a minute. Also, if you have insulin resistance, you're more prone to have type 2 diabetes in the future. Second thing is hyperandrogenism. And hyperandrogenism is when you have high levels of androgens in your body. And as I said, this can be diagnosed both by observation or by blood tests. And there are different types of androgens in our body. But generally, hyperandrogenism can cause stuff like excessive hair growth in the areas of the body that are usually connected to male hormonal profile, such as, for example, chin, chest, lower back or a bum, and a belly, for example. Second thing can be acne, and third thing can be hair loss. So all sorts of patchiness, losing hair and stuff like that. It's very important to preface as well that very often hair loss can be caused by a lot of different things. So hair loss itself might not be caused by hyperandrogenism. It can be caused, for example, by other hormonal issues like thyroid and so on and so forth. Now, insulin resistance can cause high androgen levels as well, especially if there are high levels of testosterone, because you can have high levels of different androgens. They might be, for example, the high levels of testosterone, or there might be high levels of DHEA hormones, which is also androgen, but this is a stress hormone that is released by our adrenals. So there are a few types of androgens, and there are a few ways in which they are going to be created. And yes, you can have hyperandrogenism without having PCOS, and you can have PCOS without having hyperandrogenism, or you can have it with or without insulin resistance as well. Now, third thing, as I mentioned, is polycystic ovaries in the ultrasonogram. Now, not everybody has polycystic ovaries, so actually the scientists are talking about changing the name of the syndrome altogether, which again is mentioned in my PCOS diagnostic criteria. But that is one thing that can also be happening with women in PCOS. Many women think that the big cysts on ovaries are caused by PCOS, but that is not necessarily the truth. The small tiny cysts that are actually unreleased eggs with ovulation are the ones that are actually connected the most with PCOS. Now, both insulin resistance and both hyperandrogenism can then cause polycystic ovaries as well, but they can also cause other problems. For example, irregular or absent periods altogether, then irregular or absent ovulation, which then causes fertility problems and can cause also all our cells in the body to not work properly. So if you see the connection, it's kind of tangled all together. So if you have insulin resistance, you're higher prone to actually develop polycystic ovarian syndrome. Although the origin of polycystic ovarian syndrome is probably a completely separate video. However, if you already have insulin resistance, it might also contribute to lack of ovulation. So addressing insulin resistance can also address the lack of ovulation, and addressing insulin resistance can address your hyperandrogenism, and so on and so forth. So what are the risks later in life? Later in life, you can develop a lot of array of things. So directly, for example, from insulin resistance, you can develop type 2 diabetes. From having all of those symptoms, you can develop depression and anxiety, also due to the fact of how energy is created in your body. Because, for example, if you have very high levels of insulin resistance, you might be very fatigued, so they can cause depression as well. However, if you have very high DHEA levels, they're high androgens, high adrenal androgens, you might have anxiety as well. Or just the imbalance and the problem with dealing with stuff like excessive hair growth and so on can cause these problems as well. Also, later in life, of course, you can develop something like very high blood sugars, you can develop fatty liver disease, high cholesterol levels that then can cause also heart disease and so on. You can also, if you're a person that is, for example, very obese, you can develop sleep apnea. Or if you have no periods for a long time, you have increased risk of endometrial cancer, which is your uterus cancer, uterus lining cancer actually. So these are the most common symptoms with PCOS, and what causes what is of course a very difficult thing because there is a full cycle to it. Make sure you follow me on Instagram as well, because I put a lot of graphics in there with a lot of valuable information about PCOS. And make sure you like, subscribe and click the notification bell to be notified about my future videos, and I'll see you very soon. Bye.